Good morning. Today's date is January 16th, 2007. My name is Thomas Murray. Today I'm conducting an oral history interview with George Runz. This interview is being held at the Dalton Community Television Studio in Dalton, Massachusetts, in association with the Dalton Council on Aging. Good morning, George.
Good morning, Peter.
Could you give us your full name, spelling your last name, please?
George C. Runz, R-U-N-Z.
And where do you presently live?
Beckett, Mass.
What is your birth date?
April 19th, 1913.
And where were you born?
In Long Island City.
That's in New York?
In New York, yeah, mm-hmm. Long Island, yeah.
Yeah. Did you grow up and go to school there?
I went to the kindergarten in New York and then to the first grade up in Berkshire, Mass.
Okay, so you moved up to Berkshire when you were, what, about six or so, you said?
I was what?
About six?
Oh, yes, five, six. We would come out of the kindergarten. So
you started in the first grade?
Up here, I started in the first grade, yeah.
And where is Berkshire up here?
Berkshire is in Lanesboro.
It's a part
of Lanesboro.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And now you were a little older than most of the kids because of the fact.
I spent a year in kindergarten where the kids up here never had to go to kindergarten. They went right into the first grade.
Mm-hmm.
So the kids my age were all 1 year ahead of me. That bothered me sometimes. Mm-hmm.
Why did you move up here? Was there?
Well, my mother was down in Long Island City with a family. My father was away working on the smokestacks, chimneys, bricklayer. So he was away most of the time. And that left my mother there with the family, and the neighborhoods we lived in wasn't the greatest. So it was to the benefit the family,
mm-hmm.
why they come up mostly, I guess.
And what was it like growing up as a kid up here?
Well, I was just telling your friend here, we had the best of times as kids, going to school and all the activities we had. Of course, we made our own activities, but there were activities, skied, ice skated, different outside. We camped out, built our own shack in the woods, and would bring dinner and stay out all day, and have a good time with the kids. So we got along fine. Ice skating, a lot of ice skating, and the thing of it was at the time, the parents used to come out more and ski with us, skate with us. On a good Sunday, or the ice was good, weather was good, we'd have some mob on there, all the parents and all the kids, whole families were out there skating, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They were more together than they are today, I don't know. Seemed to be anyway.
Now your school, that was what, like a two-room school, wasn't it? They had four
two grade. Rooms, yes. Yeah. Four down and four up in the eighth grades.
Now you had kind of a funny story I'd like you to tell, and that's your fire drill story, that where you were being punished.
Well, I got in some trouble. I don't know what it was, but the teacher put me in the corner. That was punishment at that time. And while I was in the corner, the fire drill went off. And I stayed right there. The teacher she got her class out in record time, I guess. And Well, she forgot me in standing in the corner. So I was stubborn. I said, well, if that's the way you want it, that's the way you're going to get it. I stayed right in the corner. And when she come back in, she was surprised. And she covered it up pretty well by saying, oh, look, there's little George and he's burnt to a crisp. Well, that made me mad. I wasn't any better company after that, that's for sure.
And then there was a, you talked about a sled ride that you and your brother had gone, you were in the Boy Scouts or something?
Oh, yeah. We went over to Lanesboro, and the Boy Scouts were building a camp. And this farmer gave him permission to go on his property and build a cabin or camp. And that was over in Lanesboro on the you went off Route 7 and up into the mountains on the New York state side. And when we were up there this Saturday, and there was my brother and a cousin. He was my age. And it come time to quit that evening, and we went, got the sled. It was a flexible flyer, and that was the king then. And we got all the gear loaded, and we started down off that hill, and we rode right down into Dalton, up on Route 7 today, and down to the foot of Brennan's Hill. Well, we walked up the hill, and of course, that road was all iced over too, so we started up the top of Brennan's Hill and went down all the way down that road over to road right past the spring before we come to a stop. And we were moving, hanging onto that sled. That was quite a ride.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Now, something else you mentioned about the Berkshire area was the skiing at the Berkshire Park. There was an old park up there at one time.
Yeah, it was before my time. They had, when I was there, they had the cages were still there. That they had animals in it. It was a regular zoo up there. And that was run by the Berkshire Railroad. And they evidently had good crowds. People used to come in on weekends and spend weekends here. It was quite a park, evidently.
But there was parts of it still left when you...
Oh, yeah, the cages were still there when I was...
Mm-hmm. And wasn't there a ski jump, too, you said?
Yes, and there was a ski jump there. And we went up there one day, and it was a weekend. And they were having a ski meet there. And they were using the jump. They were jumping. And they weren't local skiers. We knew none of the skiers. So they must have brought in skiers that were jumpers, you know, knew how to ski.
Mm-hmm.
And so we watched them all day going over that jump. It was exciting for us, never seen it before. And of course, as kids, we were right at the foot of the jump. And they were coming down and landing right in front of us. So it was quite an exciting day. We had a good enjoyment out of it.
And you mentioned, too, that as you got older, you did a lot of trapping and to earn some money.
Trapping, help. Yeah. We trapped muskrat, and mostly. Once in a while, a skunk. But,
you mentioned you caught a mink, too, once, didn't you?
We had, a couple of them. I think, three mink in all. But the one mink that I remember the most, we got $28 for.
Wow.
And that covered all the expense for the whole trapping season, new traps and whatever. I remember catching a skunk. So when we got into school, all the girls were, you know, turning up their noses. So the teachers asked, who caught a skunk them today? Well, all the boys that trapped put up their hands. Oh, she said, you all didn't catch a skunk. So she's going around smelling us. Sure, she got to me, and she said, you're the one that caught the skunk. So I had the rest of the day off. So what did I do? I go and set more skunk traps. So that was the end of that.
And so you went through grade school there.
Yes.
In Berkshire.
Graduated.
Mm-hmm. And then where did you go?
I went down to Pomeroy in Pittsfield, and I didn't stay there long. It was too much of a transition. The work they were doing in the ninth grade in Pittsfield wasn't a continuation of the eighth grade in Berkshire. So I was kind of out there in left field. So they had started the vocational school there. So that was my opportunity to get out of there. And I got into vocational. And we had a carpenter there. He was teaching us carpentry. Mm-hmm. Mandel, Mr. Mandel. And I got along well there, making different things, and we had quite a shop doing repair work for different organizations, one thing or another.
So you left there a little early, though, didn't you? You didn't graduate.
A family moved down to Long Island, and I left there 3 or 4 months before graduation, so I never graduated out of there. But at the time, you couldn't buy a job as a carpenter anyway. It was during the Depression, mm-hmm. and it was carpenters that were out of work, and you couldn't get a job as a carpenter. Mm-hmm. Just too many men out of work.
Yeah. Now, did you have any brothers and sisters?
Yes, I had Marty, Eleanor, and then myself, and Lewis. Then later, John. Mm-hmm. So
there was
three brothers and one sister.
Mm-hmm. So what did your dad do for a living? You mentioned before.
He was a bricklayer.
He was a bricklayer.
Built smokestacks. But most of his work was away where these areas were. Niagara Falls, I think he worked in Niagara Falls an awful lot. At that time was when they were building that power plant in Niagara on the river. Mm-hmm. And a lot of his work was there. It's later, in later years, he took us around and showed us where stacks that he had built. And there was stacks all over Niagara where he had worked on. So they did a lot of work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, he got that trade from your mother's family, right? They came.
Yeah. My mother's family, there was 13 in her family. I think there was about 7, 8 boys. And they were all bricklayers, and my grandfather was a bricklayer. So they started, they were building the Queensboro Bridge at the time. And one of my uncles was the foreman on the job. And my father was working for the streetcar, working on a trolley car, conductor, motorman, whatever. And my uncle got him a job working as a with the bricklayers on the bridge. And of course he couldn't lay brick at the time, but he worked, they gave him a job on the donkey engine. And it ran the elevator, took the bridge, the material up to the bricklayers up the top of the bridge so he could, they'd have the materials, the brick and the mortar, one thing or another. And he had a little metal shack that went over the motor. And of course he was under that most of the time. But the other laborers evidently resented his being there because his boss was a foreman and he got all the gravy while these other guys were out there sweating, I guess. But every once in a while a red bricker would come down and there's a bang on the top of his tin house there. So he couldn't step out of that thing. He always had to be careful to look up, see if anything was coming down. But he got through that period, and his brother-in-law has put him on the job laying brick, I guess. They taught him anyway. They must have taught him well. He worked for Rust Engineering Company, and he was a foreman on that job, so he knew the trades.
Worked his way up.
Yeah. Huh?
Worked his way up.
Yeah. He was foreman and hired the men. He would go to a strange city that he'd have to get all his laborers from the particular area where he was working. And that was his job, getting these laborers rounded up and mm-hmm. getting men that were able to do the work. And that was a problem. I remember talking about that. It was probably fun for him being in a different city every change of jobs.
Yeah, yeah.
But he did spend a lot of time in Niagara.
Yeah.
Niagara was buzzing at that time, I guess, with the generators, plants, yeah. One thing or another.
Now both the your grandparents, both on your mother and father's side, were immigrants, weren't they? From your
my grandfather and grandmother on my mother's side come over from England. Yes, my grandmother and grandfather came over from Germany on my father's side.
Mm-hmm.
But there was three boys in my father's family, and then of course, the 13 of my mother's family.
Mm-hmm.
So it was no contest there.
Was your father a veteran?
No, he, his age and with the family, with his family, he missed that draft in the First World War. But I had an uncle that, my father's younger brother, he was drafted, Uncle Louis.
And that was World War One.
World War One, mm-hmm. Yes. I remember him teaching my younger brother. They'd ask him who won the war, and they'd say Uncle Louis won the war. Well, Uncle Louis got over there, and he was a prisoner of war. So, how much winning the war he did, I don't know.
But he could speak German, couldn't he? So he.
He spoke German, and he was getting extra food for himself and the other guys that were in the cell with him. So they made out. You see, they made out all right, with the food.
Now you told too when he come home, you went. What was it into Manhattan to see if you could?
Yeah, we went over to Manhattan. His company was at the command, and they were paraded. And they were doing that for all companies. But we never did get to see them, because every place you looked, there's somebody in uniform, and soldier in uniform. And never did get to see him in the parade. Mm-hmm. But he was there.
Now, you mentioned before you didn't graduate from high school, right? Because you left early?
No, I graduated from high school. I didn't graduate from the trade school.
Oh, okay.
I left that early. Mm-hmm. That's when my mother moved down from Massachusetts to Army back in New York State again, mm-hmm. on Long Island.
So you had to go to work to kind of help out?
Yeah. The father and mother were separated at that time. So I went to work, and brother and sister worked, so.
And we figured out that was around 1927 in that era. And jobs were pretty hard to come by.
Must have been a little bit later than 27. We had a car at the time, a Whippet, and that was a 1927 Whippet. And that was 2-3 years old.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm. I remember the time, so it must have been a little after 27.
Okay. And you did various jobs. You said you worked in ice cream shops and...
Oh, when I got jobs were hard to come by. Yeah.
Work wherever you...
Any place you could get any work with a little pay. I worked in an ice cream store, mixing up sodas, mostly washing glasses. Yeah, that was, I think we got $8 a week, so that's...
Now, you mentioned, were you drafted or did you enlist in the...
I enlisted.
You enlisted in the
reserves?
Navy Reserves.
Huh? Yeah, I enlisted in the Navy Reserves.
And how old were you about at that time?
I must have been of legal age. I don't ever remember getting my mother's permission, so I must have been above the...
Whatever you had to be.
Legal then. Age at that time. Yeah. I forget what it was.
And we figured that was about 1930 to 38 you were in, your dates of service?
Yeah. The service at that time was, it was more like the Boy Scouts. You didn't, they didn't make it toe the line on all these rules and regulations. You kind of get away with a lot of that stuff.
Now, how did you get to join the Navy? Why did you join the Navy?
I was in the reserves. I never did.
Yeah, but how did you get in the reserves? You told that story about your brother.
Yeah, Marty worked for Ingersoll Rand, and he had two brothers that were in the reserves. And they used to would tell him stories, evidently, about how they made out in the reserves and what they did. So he decided he's going to join the reserves. And he had to have company, so he tapped me. And we went down and took the physicals. I took the physical and passed, and signed up in the reserves. And come to find out, Marty didn't pass the tests. He had a heart murmur, so they wouldn't accept him in the reserves. So that left me out there, and he took off. I wound up in the Naval Reserves.
Now, you said you signed up on it was like a gunboat or something? And
That was where we trained, the USS Wheeling, and it was a gunboat. And that was anchored on in New York City on 23rd Street Dock. And that's where we went to once a week to do our training. Mm-hmm. The USS Wheeling.
So you didn't go to any boot camp or anything back then, did you?
No boot camp. We went right into the reserves there. That's where you got your training.
And what were you? What was your rate? What were you?
Well, you went in as a seaman. Mm-hmm. And I got up to first class. I wasn't too active, for studying or furthering myself. That wasn't in my mind at that time. We got a day's pay for going to that meeting once a week. And that was paid, I think, every 3 months. So that was probably one of the reasons I stayed in. Mm-hmm. Because it was the Depression at that time. And you got that, I think it was, well, I forget, I think I got 80 cents, for a night in the first part. I was getting $1.60, something like that, first-class seaman when I quit. But that check used to come in handy every 3 months. It wasn't much, but you didn't need much at that time.
Now, you mentioned one of your first times that you remember, you went to Newburgh on the Hudson.
I joined, and they were taking a cruise at weekend, I guess. Jesus, they set me up with a uniform. I was supposed to be a sorry-looking mess. And we got up to Newburgh, and the Liberty boat wouldn't—they couldn't get it started. So everybody was teed off. I was teed off too. But when I got to look at myself in that uniform they gave me, I was glad I didn't get a shirt. I was a sorry-looking sailor at that time.
And what are some of the destroyers you were on that you went on your cruises?
See, I don't remember all of them. Fox was one, and the Bernadou was another one. But we went on others, and I can't recall what they were. Why I remember them too, I don't know. But
you took one cruise to Bermuda.
That was on a destroyer. I think that was the Fox. took weekend cruises a lot of. They were all destroyers. Mm-hmm. Took a 2 weeks cruise on the battleship Arkansas. That was a nice trip for us. It's different. Big guns. 14-inch guns, I guess you had.
On that cruise to Bermuda, you mentioned you went down there during Prohibition back here. So you got to tip a little, didn't you?
Yeah, that was a novelty. You got down there, you could walk in a bar and order a beer, and they set a beer in front of you. You could order whiskey, I guess, too, but I never drank it at that time. But I sat there with a big beer in my hand and got half loaded. That was an understatement. But we had a good time.
And they didn't have many vehicles there either, you mentioned.
No, at the time, there was only emergency vehicles. Fire trucks, they had an ambulance and stuff like that, but you couldn't order a taxi to take a ride someplace. You wanted to go someplace, it was a horse and buggy. Went by horse and buggy. Well, things moved a lot slower at that time. There was no need to go any place fast. Yeah. But it was nice at the time. The weather was something we weren't used to. the people. They had a big ballroom there, dancing at night. Of course, we couldn't go into the dance with the uniform, but we stood on the outside and watched them.
Now, another cruise you mentioned, you went up through the Cape Cod Canal.
Yeah, we went through the Cape Cod Canal. That was a nice trip. Of course, the people are standing all along the canal and all giving you the high sign, you know. Mm-hmm. That was a nice trip through there.
But as you mentioned, you were kind of a non-conforming sailor, weren't you? You really...
I didn't conform to anything. And the funny part, looking back, nobody cared either. It didn't seem to anyway. The officers weren't on your back, so nobody was beating you up to do something. But I guess maybe we did it anyway, you know, what we were supposed to do. Without being beat over the head to do it.
Now you mentioned earlier one guy that just joined the reserves come on with you and he had a problem. You mentioned earlier he slipped on the deck or...
Oh, when he went overboard?
Yeah.
he was only a kid. Kid, I was a kid myself. And on his first cruise, matter of fact, it was his first time he was on board any Navy vessel. And he got up to go to the head during the night, and it was foggy, I guess, and everything was wet. And he's going along the deck, and he slipped, and down he went, and up through the cables and overboard. And luckily, the guy that was on duty on the after deck house spotted him. Normally, that guy would be asleep back there. But I guess it was early in the evening. He gave out the man overboard and threw a preserver over. They went out, and they turned around and brought him back. They picked him up. So we often thought, what were the chances of him being picked up? If somebody just missed him, he'd have been out in the Atlantic Ocean. Yeah. That would have been it. And they would never know what happened to him. Why he slipped through the cables, I don't know, but that's what he did. And he never came to another meeting. He figured that was enough for him. Bored in the middle of the night.
So you signed up for a second hitch, though, didn't you?
Yes, I did. And why, I don't know. I wasn't that much in love with the reserves. Something must have happened at the time. Probably that money coming in every 3 months was probably part of it. Mm-hmm. Just for going to one meeting a month. And we had good times, right? When we went out.
Now, you got married about that time too, didn't you? Around 19 or so?
Yeah.
And you had your first child about a year later?
Well, I was 20 when Catherine was born. Of course, I always figured I'm 20 years older than she is. But the way I figured it out was the first year I was 20 and she was zip. So I was twice as old as she was. So as time went on, I got to the point where today, I'm 90 and she's 70. So I'm not twice as old as her anymore. So I figured if we both live long enough, we'll be the same age. Figured it that way, but I'm twice as old as my daughter.
Now, again, work was hard to come by, and you started getting some work on the WPA projects?
Yeah, I worked a couple of WPA projects, school lunches for one at a time.
You mentioned getting a pretty good job with the state, but didn't last too long.
I got a job with the state with the Department of Agriculture on a Dutch elm disease. I took the training for the federal government, the job. And when I come to find out, I was making as much money at the time as they were paying these federal workers. So I didn't go to work for the federal. But then they come up with, the state come up with jobs on Dutch elm disease to work in the state parks. And so I took that, but that was $6 a day. And man, that was living. That was really living, $6 mm-hmm. a day. And
but it didn't last very long, did it? It was
two paydays. And the other fellows that were working on for the federal government were working the same job, the same areas, and getting, something like $90 a month. And here we are getting $6 an hour. They didn't like it. You can understand why, too.
Yeah.
Plus, we were given a pickup truck. It was a little Chevrolet. It was small. But we had that to drive around. The other guys had a hike on foot. And we pass them by, give them the high sign.
Now, as times got tougher, you decided to move back to Beckett.
Yeah, it got so bad down there. Most of the homes had coal stoves in them at that time. And the gas, the natural gas that they had, in a lot of cases, they didn't pay the bill, so it was turned off. So the only way they had to heat any food at all was to get a wooden box, whatever. You couldn't go out and cut wood. There's no wood to cut. If you get caught cutting wood, they'd probably arrest you. So there was nothing. You had nothing. You couldn't even had a fight to get an orange crate to heat some soup or something up in. So, your father invited me up to stay up there. So, we went up into Massachusetts, and when you got up here, at least you took an axe and you went out and you cut yourself some wood, cut a couple of trees down, and you could heat up a can of soup if you're at the price of the soup. But we always managed. Of course, we had an old shotgun. I remember getting rabbits and partridge. Your mother cooking up a stew. And really having a feast. Plus, we planted a garden that year. That fall, we had 18 bushel of potatoes. And I think it was something like 10 bushel of turnip. Then there was carrots, and had them down a cellar. We built bins for them. And I can remember we went out one time We come back with, I think it was three or four rabbits and half a dozen partridge. So your mother took them and put them all together and made a stew out of them. And we had a feast. Potatoes, turnip, carrots. We were eating like kings. Yeah. You see, we're down in the city, you couldn't go out and get a partridge or a rabbit or nothing. Up there, at least you're able to help yourself. That's one of the things that held us up there, mm-hmm. or up here.
And plus, they had some cows on the farm. So you had milk and.
Tommy's grandparents had a farm there, and they had a couple of cows. So we had milk. And there was always milk gravy, a little flour to thicken it up with your potatoes and turnip. And believe me, when you come out of the city, you couldn't help yourself at all, nothing to help yourself with. And you run into that, it was heaven, you know. Mm-hmm. And we took advantage of it.
Now, you did get some work on some government projects up there, too, didn't you, on the bug gang, they called
it? Yeah, we worked for the Department of Agriculture. Gypsy moth control. Worked on that for, maybe a year. And then that petered out.
You told a story one time, though, you went in on snowshoes and it started raining and...
The day I started working, well, we called it the bug gang, gypsy moth. We went in on snowshoes, and there was probably 4 or 5 feet on the ground. So we got in there, and it started to rain. And it was a warm rain. So we worked a little past noontime, and the boss finally figured we better quit and get out of there. And when we got out of there, it was raining, warm rain, and the next morning there was no snow in the woods at all. It took all the, I'd say 3 or 4 foot out of the ground, and that the runoff was terrific. All the brooks, Walker Brook going down to Chester, was overflowing, and the river coming down from Middlefield, that was overflowing. And we did get around the back roads to get down to Chester, and the railroad bridge was covered with water, and there was an engine stalled on the upper side of that bridge. They couldn't get through. But coming down the river, there was chicken coops, and outhouses, and all out buildings, riding the top of the swift running brook there. Brook, it was a river. And there was one of those chicken bouncing down the top of these things. And there was chickens on the roof, fighting a snap on the top of the thing. That was a flood of
37, I think it was. So about around 1939, you said you went back to Long Island and got a job there at the hospital.
Well, I didn't get a job the first thing at the hospital, but I worked a number of jobs, anything you could get. But I finally wound up at the state hospital. And I got a job there. And I figured the pay was terrible, terribly low. But it was there twice a month. It was there, there was no question about it being laid off. You kept your nose clean, you stayed on the job. And for that reason, I stayed there. I stayed there and stayed there. War broke out and jobs began to open up. But I figured with my luck, if I quit the hospital and went to work for Republic or Grumman's, they were out there. These guys were out there making overtime. They were making a lot of money, good money. And I could have done the same thing, but I figured with my luck, if I did that, the war would be over the next day and I'd be out looking for a job again. That's what happened. So I stayed on that job. And today, I see the same fellows I knew at the time, and still do. I'm further ahead than they are. Although they, for the war, end of the war years and several years after, they had plenty of money and they did all right. But they are further ahead today than I am, so mm-hmm. In the long run, I...
Now, you mentioned that the hospital had a blanket deferment.
Deferment, but... yeah. When it come my turn to... I got a notice from the, I don't know, War Department or Navy, that if I signed up for another hitch, I would get a rating that I was striking for at the time, carpenter's mate. But I still was under that business of, if I did that, the war would be over and I'd be out looking for a job again. And I didn't want any part of that. They really got to me, that part of it. I couldn't quit that job no more than, no way I could quit the job voluntarily.
Yeah.
And feel good about it. So I didn't. So.
But it was a tough 4 years working there during the war, wasn't it? Because of the lack of help?
It was lack of help plus lack of supplies, clothing for the patients. Blankets for their beds, or shorter blankets. God, it was there were tough years to work there. But we survived.
You said they ate cabbage soup most of the time.
Well, I had a big farm at the hospital, and cabbage was a quick, easy crop to grow, and they grew a lot of cabbage this year. And they, of course, they had pigs, pig farm there too. And they butchered the pigs and used the, most of it was the fat. I think the doctors got the pork chops. We got the scraps, you know. But the patients got what we couldn't eat. And it was mostly fat, but they cooked this cabbage up in this fat. And the patients, Jesus, they gobbled it down. It was the only thing they had to eat. Cabbage soup. Jesus, cabbage soup for a couple of months there. I don't know where they stored all the cabbage, but they did.
You mentioned one day they got some good meat because of the...
The inspector was coming. We knew it as employees here, but some of the patients were a little hep, and they figured that one out too. And the one guy hollers out, "Hey, there's meat in this soup today. The inspectors must be coming." And they did.
Now, you had a story, too, about the rocking chair story where...
Oh, they had... I worked as a barber during the day, and then I worked the next 8 hours as an attendant. So I went to work from 4 to 12 as an attendant. And I went to work on the wards. What was this?
The rocking chair.
The rocking chair, yeah. So there was, the buildings were, there was eight wards in the building. And one of the wards was what they referred to as a suicidal ward. And all the patients that were prone to commit suicide were housed in that particular ward. And outside of that was the other 7 wards. So I would go to work from 4 to 12, and other guys would go to work from 4 to 8. And when they quit at 8 o'clock, I would wind up in the building numbers of times, having 7 wards. And they're on 2 floors. So you got the patients to bed before 8 o'clock while you had a couple extra employees. And you took on from there, but I was sitting down in what they call the center of the building where the door comes in off the street to the front door. And that was the way any of the doctors that were coming in down would trip. So you'd hear them coming in. Mm-hmm. So I'm sitting there in a chair, this big wicker chair, sound asleep. I don't know, it must have been probably 11 o'clock or so. And of course, when the keys hit the front door, I come up out of the seat pretty fast. But when I got up, the chair was rocking, and the doctor standing there looking at the chair rocking. So he said, he knew what I had been asleep, so he said, what ward are you supposed to be on? I said, I have 7 wards. I said, I'll go on any one of the 7 you want, but I can only be on one at a time. Which ward would you like me to go on? He says, you mean to tell me you have 7 wards? I says, there's only one other employee in the building. He's on the suicide ward. Yes, I have 7 wards. He says, get back in a chair, he says, and go to sleep. And he walked out. So.
And all the doctors weren't always that great either, were they?
Some of them were out, they'd sneak in the ward. We used to claim these guys had rubber keys. They'd be sneaking. You'd be awake and you knew they were coming. The car would pull up in front and you knew they were coming anyway. And they'd try and sneak in the ward and catch them sleeping. The keys go nice and easy and turn on. They'd try and sneak in, and the one door squeaked. Wake up half a mile away.
But weren't the doctors, you said too that, because they were so short-handed, they would bring in doctors that may not really...
They didn't know what they were doing half the time. The doctors were, how they ever passed any examinations, I don't know. We had one doctor that came one. He was smart enough, it's just that he didn't hit the right things. But he took tests in several states. And finally he passed the New York State. And Jesus, he was elated when he passed that test.
So you stayed there obviously through the war, and now you lost a brother in the war.
Yes, yeah. Younger brother. Plus, my mother was due for an operation. Gallbladder? Yeah. At the time, she got the notice that John was missing. And she never recovered. She went on to the operation, but she never recovered from it. So we had my mother and the brother at the same time.
She never knew he actually was killed, that he was missing.
He was missing when she died.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was in December of 1944. He was in the Battle of the Bulge, wasn't
that? Yeah. He was killed in Holland.
I think Luxembourg, I had seen.
Luxembourg, yeah.
Now, after the war, things started getting a little better at the hospital, didn't they? In terms of conditions, working conditions?
Yeah, the conditions got much better. They loosened up on some of the money, and tenants got raises for the first time. I had been there a number of years. It was like the first raise you ever got. And the raises weren't that great. They paid a percentage of your salary as the raise. But the longer you were there, you got a percentage on the salary you were making. Now, the next time you got a raise, you got a percentage on a raise on your salary you were making now. So you kept jumping up. The ones that were on a higher scale kept going
a little higher and
higher. Finally got to the point where these guys weren't doing too bad, you know, for the times. So they had to change that plan. Burton, he was the guy up at Albany, politician, the Burton plan. We heard so much about the Burton plan.
Yeah.
So they instituted that. That worked for a while, but then that ran into problems too. So they had to change that. So then everybody had to start from scratch. They give them, everybody got their raises, what they would do, and then they started over from scratch again on what the salary you made. You were never overpaid. You know, you were behind everybody on the outside anyway.
Yeah. Now, in the early 50s, you lost your first wife.
Yeah.
And now you had, with her, you had, was it four girls and one boy for children?
Four boys and a girl, yeah.
No, four girls it was.
Yeah. Three girls and then a boy.
And then you had Patty, was the youngest.
Patty was the youngest, yeah.
And then you remarried, and you had another.
Wife died, and I remarried. We had one more child.
Mm-hmm. So you worked at the hospital until you retired?
Yes, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so when you were getting ready to retire, you did do a little work on the outside, too, to get your license?
I got my barber's license and went to work as a barber on the outside. I worked for a couple of years for extra money. That's where I bought the camper.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I went on all the trips.
And then you built a place up in Beckett.
Built a place in Beckett. And stayed there, I think, for three, 4 years. and went back down to.
Well, then you moved up permanently up here, though, and after you
retired. Oh, yeah, you're right, yeah. I would jump ahead of myself. Yeah, we moved up and built the a summer place as a vacation home. That's what we're living in today, what was built as a vacation home at the time. Mm-hmm. But then we moved up there permanently, and there's no more vacation home.
Now you're here all the time. Yeah. And so until recently, you would, you know, you had a garden and things that you took care of?
Yeah, we always had a garden. I had a garden for years. Yeah, we always had a garden.
And the blueberries and all
yeah,
that.
Blueberries, blackberries. We always had potatoes and turnip, one thing or another, carrots, peas. With the freezing compartments, deep freeze, we put up a lot more vegetables than you would trying to can them.
Yeah, yeah.
Because we froze peas and carrots and stuff like that. It was much easier than trying to, you know, process them.
Yeah.
And do them up the we used to years ago, because canning season was a chore time. Trying to get all the stuff together, canned.
Yeah. So, on your Navy career, do you think that had any effect on your life at all, or didn't you really?
Well, overall, probably yes. I got to see different things, what different places I wouldn't have been otherwise. But it didn't interfere with my social life too much. You know, we got along.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know we got a few pictures we want to look at, so why don't we do that now?
Okay.
Before we look at the pictures, we forgot to mention that you served quite some time in the fire department on Central Islip.
I spent I'm still in the fire department. I'm on a reserve inactive list, and I'm still in the fire department. Mm-hmm. I can go to all functions, any function the fire department has. I can go. Mm-hmm.
But you joined in the 40s, was it? Right after the war started?
The draft started first. I think they were drafting before the war, but that was at the beginning of the war. Mm-hmm. So I joined the fire department. They were short of men. They were taking some of the men out of the fire department, and they were drafting them, so things got rough there. You didn't have much choice. Mm-hmm. We joined the fire department. Mike Rattle got a hold of me one day. He says, "What are you doing?" I says, "Nothing." He says, "You're joining the fire department." I says, "Oh." So we went down, we joined the fire department, both of us. So that was the start of the. Mm-hmm.
And you worked your way up to chief, didn't you?
Yeah, I was fire commissioner too. Mm-hmm.
So you've got over 60 some years in the fire department to date.
Yeah, yeah. And still going.
And still going.
Yeah.
Well, that's good. And that was a volunteer fire department.
Just yeah, that so was a volunteer, yeah. And it was an outlet too for me. Of course, I was married with children and didn't have much money to have a social life. So when we joined the fire department, we had one fellow play the piano and another, Joe Erdman, played the drums on a Friday night. All during the summer, about every week, we have a parade someplace. One of the departments will have a parade, so you wind up going to the parade, and you would bring the drummer and the piano player, and we'd find a piano. And we'd have a dance. Of course, the ladies of auxiliary marched with us, and Catherine was always at these parades. So you wound up with a social life.
Mm-hmm.
And we ran, had some good times. We was in a gin mill one night and we had no piano. So Stretch Taylor had a piano in his home. So they go over with one of the fire trucks and go to Stretch's house. Pull up, go in and take his piano, put it in the back of the truck, and away we go to the gin mill. And we had to take the fire truck back.
So you still had your party.
Still had our party, yeah. Why everybody wind up half in a bag.
That was an important part of your life, though. You spent a lot of time.
That was my social life. That was that was it. I had no money to spend on any social life, you know.
Yeah.
Of course, when we went to the terminal, first thing we bought was a keg of beer. We'd buy a keg of beer from the bartender, and we'd get it for his price, and we'd all have a good time.
Yeah. Well, let's... let's look at some of your Navy pictures here. This first one, that's when you were on the Arkansas.
Yeah.
And you mentioned this guy right there was the, you thought he was the captain?
The captain.
Of the ship then?
Yeah.
And here's another photo of the Arkansas. You can see the big guns there.
Guns sticking out.
Yeah. And this is you standing in front of there. You look pretty snappy in that uniform. You must have got a new uniform from...
I don't think I weighed over 120 pounds there.
Now, this is an interesting... On this... can you see it on the monitor, Uncle George, over there?
Yeah.
That's just some of the guys that you were with?
Yeah.
Do you remember what this cruise was that you were on, or?
That must have been up in the canal. I didn't think it was, but I think it's just the Cape Cod Canal.
Uh-huh.
Boston Harbor.
And this here is just some more of the guys on the ship. And this guy, do you remember him?
Yeah.
Is that you?
That's me.
Yeah. Now, this one here was interesting because you're with a dog there. They had dogs on the, they allowed dogs?
Well, just the one dog, yeah.
Uh-huh.
He was the ship's mascot, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
What I call
him. Yeah.
And he was a well-behaved dog. I remember him.
And this here... is another picture of the big guns.
Uh-huh.
So, well, we want to thank you so much for taking the time to share your experiences with us, and thank you for the service you gave to our country and to your community.
It was a pleasure, Tim, and thank you.
Thank you.
like if I'd never met you, about all the things I'd missed. Sometimes it's so hard to believe when a love can be so strong. And faith gave me the strength and kept me holding on. You are the love of my life, and I'm so glad you found me. You are the love of my life. Baby, put your arms around me. I guess this is how it feels.